Jesus and the disciples were still in the upper room, late at night. Today's passage is about the last lesson. The time Jesus came into this world was a very difficult time to live. It's not like our time, present time. There was a severe poverty. Poor parents sold their sons and daughters as slaves, or sold themselves as slaves because of poverty. We know from the Bible, one widow, all she had was one coin. That's all her property, one coin. It shows how people were so poor in Jesus' time. There were wars almost non-stop because the Romans were expanding at the time. Many conquered people became slaves. Many injured and died. You know, the war at that time is just unimaginable because it is man to man and cut with the knife and pierced with, you know. People often saw dying people on the cross, crucified by the Romans, because that's the death sentence. All except the Roman citizens, death sentence was crucifixion. They can frequently crucifixion was done. There were almost no medicine, no hospital, no public schools, no electricity, no refrigerator, no TV, no cell phone. Women spent almost all day to draw water from well, to grind grains for next meal. They carried their laundry to the riverside or lakeside to wash it in primitive ways. Ruthless authorities killed righteous people. If we had lived in Jesus' time, how many of us could have survived? Yet Jesus said, "I have overcome the world." Jesus said, "He overcame the world." Any generation, any time period we live in, there are troubles in the world. Some people overcome troubles, some people don't. Some people cannot overcome troubles. Jesus wants his disciples to overcome the world. Yesterday, during teenagers' Bible study, Junior mentioned about one of his classmates said, what his classmate said, middle school boy, he said, "This world is corrupt. The wicked people grab power. Once they grab power, they remain in power until their death. There is no hope in this world." He said, "I have given up any hope in this world. There is nothing I can do. I just live till I die." This young student, you know, middle school student, Junyoung's friend, he saw the world correctly. And he already has given up any hope in this world and in his life. Can you imagine that such a young person lives in this world hopelessly? Very soon, Jesus' disciples might think the same way, because a few hours later on, after the dinner, they would see what the world would be like. They would see the world really dark, bloody, evil. They would see Jesus tied up and covered with blood. What did Jesus do wrong? Why are they trying to kill him? The disciples would only cry until they cry no more. And they would give up. There is no hope in this world. What is the next living in fear and depression? But Jesus said, I have overcome the world. And Jesus wants disciples also to overcome the world. In the eyes of Jesus, those disciples are so precious. They are the winners. They are the victors. They are not the losers. Jesus taught to them how they can overcome the world, how they can be winners, victors in the troubled world. Jesus acknowledged that the world is not a place, this world is a place of troubles. Jesus said, in the world, you will have tribulation. That's the ESV Bible. NIV Bible says, in this world, you will have troubles. This world is not a rose garden. This world is a place of troubles. Jesus teaches the disciples how to overcome the world. Two things he teaches. First, Jesus teaches on how to look at our own sorrow and pains. We need to look at our sorrow and pains in the right perspective. There are times we think ourselves and we feel so much pain and tears run and we weep. Our pains are just like labor pain. That's what Jesus said. When we are so painful, crying, sorrowful, Jesus said, our pain is like labor pain. Among all human pains and sorrows, labor pain is different from all other pains. Labor pain is that, you know, woman has a pain to deliver baby. Labor pain. Labor pain is in intensity, a near death pain is so painful. To me, it was like someone was cutting my back with a metal saw. That's how I felt the pain. However, there is an end to this pain. There will be an end in several hours, or in a couple of hours, or in a few minutes. There is an end. And then pain will stop. To suffering people, thinking about this pain will end, it gives comfort, hope. Labor pain has a happy ending and great joy. As soon as the baby is born and cries, the room is full of happiness and joy. Doctors are happy, nurses are happy, families are excited, mother is happy. When my daughter Jane had a baby, I fell asleep in the lobby. Her mother-in-law came and woke me up about 2-3 a.m. She said, "Boksoon, Boksoon, baby's out! Baby's out!" She woke me up. She was so excited. That's labor pain. It turns to happiness and great joy. As soon as the baby is born, everything changes. Mama feels great. Even hours later of delivery, she walks around with smiles and, you know. All pains and sorrows Christians have in this world is exactly the same as labor pain. We will have pain because we carry Jesus' name.
Amen.
And the pain will be intense, but there will be an end. As soon as Jesus comes, everything changes to great joy and victory. When we know this, we can go through the pain. We will face the pain and endure to the end. We will persevere because we know in the end there is victory, great joy. Losers will give up, but we cannot give up. We will go through the pain. Labor pain doesn't hurt mothers. After delivery, they go around smiling, you know, happy, because the labor pain did not hurt her. Our pain in Jesus will not hurt us. Actually, many women are afraid to face the labor pain. But how can a baby be born? Labor pain is necessary pain to bring a new life. It is a necessary pain. Every pregnant woman has to face it. As the disciples of Jesus, as the people of Jesus, as Christians in this world, we will face troubles because we carry the name of Jesus. And it is a necessary pain that we have to go through till Jesus comes. We know that Jesus will come back. the day, this is the day of our victory, of our great joy. In that day, we will not remember any of the sufferings in the past, because the joy is so great. Our victory is guaranteed because Jesus lives forever. He resurrected. He's alive. John chapter 14, verse 2 and 3, Jesus said, "In my Father's house are many rooms. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also." John chapter 16, verse 22, "So also, you have a sorrow now, but I will see you again, and your heart will rejoice, and no one will take your joy from you." When we face a problem like a mountain, impossible problems, financial problems, health problems, children's problems, job problems, we feel helpless before our problem. Should we give up like a children's friend? No. Jesus asked, "Pray in my name and receive." This is the second point, how we can overcome the world. Pray in Jesus' name and receive. Let's read verse 23 and 4. Okay.
Until now, you have asked nothing in my name. Ask, and you will receive, and your joy may be full.
Right. Jesus said, ask in my name. Whatever you're facing problem, ask in my name, and He will give it to you. So when we receive it, our joy will be complete. No one take away the joy from us. Jesus said, He's not going to be between disciples and the Father. No, He said, you directly ask the Father. So, directly, Jesus wants the disciples directly go to God and ask and receive. Men are far away from God because of the sins. If God is in heaven, men are on earth. That much we are far away from God. God is in the most holy place, and man cannot approach God. So the priest was back and forth between God and man. Priest was back and forth. But when Jesus died, the curtain in the temple was torn from top to bottom. The curtain, we say curtain, but it was like a wall because the thickness was about 4 to 6 inches thick, the curtain. This curtain was dividing from God and man. But the curtain was torn when Jesus died. So the most holy place was wide open when we are washed by the blood of Jesus. We are no longer far away from God. We are right before the throne of God. We are not afraid of God anymore. Instead, we call God our Father, Abba Father. Knowing who our Heavenly Father is, the way to overcome the world. When we have a trouble in this world, we weep. We feel hopeless. But this is the time we go to the Father. We ask what we need in Jesus' name. And Jesus said, He will give you. We will receive. Then we don't have to cry anymore. We are winners and victors. In God, there is no more. In human, we feel hopelessness. God doesn't have that because He is Almighty God. He has no limit. I was watching my grandson and I saw the very small picture of his father, my son-in-law's father. It was black and white and maybe about half inch, very small. And the picture was so blurry, you know. It's not easy to recognize my son-in-law. I was not sure whether my grandson would recognize his father from the picture. So I showed it to my grandson and I asked them, who is it? The grandson is not 2 years old yet, you know. And my grandson answered, Daddy. He recognized his daddy from the small, you know, picture. I told about this to my son-in-law, and he was so happy. He was so moved because his son recognized him from the small picture. Our Heavenly Father is very pleased when we recognize Him. How do we recognize our Heavenly Father? It's when I'm in trouble, when I'm in a hopeless situation. When I'm in trouble, my Heavenly Father can help me. This is how we recognize our Heavenly Father in our heart. My Father, my Heavenly Father can help me, can help with this one. Amen. That is how we recognize our Father in our heart. When we don't recognize our Heavenly Father, we will fall into helplessness, depression, and we will become a loser. But Jesus said, try, pray in my name, and He will give you. In that day, you will ask nothing of me. Truly, truly, I say to you, Whatever you ask of the Father in my name, He will give it to you. Whatever. There is no limit. Because everybody has a different situation, different, you know, life problem. So, whatever. Ask. Go to Father, ask. I was praying this morning, and then I realized each prayer topic was seemingly impossible. Impossible. I was praying to God. But you know, I asked God, Lord, I trust you. I know you can do it. I know you will give me. I trust you. Like I was pushing God to the corner. You have to give me. My family moved from Ohio to Houston, so my children had to adjust to a new life in the Houston, new city. Well, everybody was okay except my son, because my son was in nursery school, and after 1 year he moved to the elementary school, private school, and after a few years, couple of years, he had to move to Parker, public school. So he moved to school, you know. He had no friend. He had no friend. It broke my heart. Really, it was so painful in my heart. I prayed to God in Jesus' name. Grant him good friends. I prayed 6 years. I prayed for 6 years. All his elementary school period, I had great pain in my heart. That's labor pain. That's labor pain. The pain will have end and will change great joy when Jesus comes. Finally, Jesus came. In the middle school, God granted him a group of friends in the middle school. When I prayed, I was praying maybe one friend or two friends. But God gave him a dozen. And they were top students in the school. Not top 10 percentile, but top from first, second, third, you know, in the rank. I couldn't choose such good friend. No sex, no drug, no violence. One mother said, I don't worry about my son because your son Samuel is his friend. And I said to her, I don't worry about my son too, because your son is my son's friend. All of them went to same high school, and their friendship continued for 6 years until they separated for college. And in college, the Lord gave him a good shepherd who led my son to Jesus. Amen. God is good. God is so good. My cup overflows. I cannot be a loser when God answers my prayer in Jesus' name.
Amen.
I cannot feel hopeless or depressed when God answers my prayer in Jesus' name. I came out winner. I moaned and groaned and weep in labor pain. But I came out as a winner. We will have trouble in this world, but we will overcome the world when we go through the troubles together with God, it will be strange if we do not overcome this world. Jesus faced his suffering, crucifixion, unimaginable pain. Jesus knew it was necessary for him to go through to bring eternal life to us. He faced the pain. He accepted the pain, knowing the end, there will be great joy, victory. Amen. Jesus knew his disciples would abandon him. He said, "You will leave me alone, yet I am not alone, for the Father is with me." The whole world attacked Jesus. Even the disciples abandoned Jesus. But Jesus depended on the Father. Jesus was praying to the Father. He was on the cross for 6 hours. We heard some of his prayer. "Father, forgive them. They do not know what they are doing." So, Jesus claims the victory. "I have overcome the world." He says to us, in the world, we will have trouble, we will have tribulation. But Jesus said, "Take a heart." Jesus wants us to overcome the world. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord. Jesus came into this world.